Robertson. I'm a guild member, been for a long time. I make jewelry out of recycled electronics like these, and I do lots of sewing. I've sewed my whole life because I have long arms and legs, and that's what you need to get things that fit you. And I like combining interesting, rich textures and colors and fabrics together. And I have a big stock of fabric, so that's why I sort of invented this banner project to show off some of the cool fabrics I have collected over the years, and figuring out in a way that it will be an interesting project for anybody to do. You don't have to be as fussy and patient as I am. You can make a good result without so much effort. But I think sewing is a lot of fun, and I just love doing it. Made out of men's ties that are already this beautiful taper, so it makes a beautiful flowy skirt. And this is a wall hanging I made for my sister's boyfriend who lives in a tree house, so it's a tree. And the tree is made out of an old sweater, and all the fabrics, very different fabrics, all appliqué, but I like the textures and the colors and the depth. So I ended up making very elaborate banners for my church this year. And they turned out so cool, Joyce thought it might be a good thing to share with people, and that's how we evolved into this banner project for this class, which is a much simpler, more handleable sized version of a cool banner. And once again, it's in interesting colors and interesting textures all mixed together. You don't have to be too fussy about the curves. The more irregular they are and the difference in width of this black space, it makes it interesting. So you don't have to obsess too much over it. You can just wing it and have fun. In the kit of materials you would get to do this class are these fabrics. Each kit is a pre-selected group of fabrics that contains enough fabrics to make the product, sometimes an extra one if I'm generous, and you can always add one of yours, but they come in various colors. There's fancy fabrics, plain fabrics, you know, it's a nice rich mix of textures and colors, and you'll be able to pick the one that's the color you like. And also included in the kit will be a pattern. And this pattern shows the whole complete project. And if you print it out full size on 3 8x10 sheets, which we can include with it, this is the full size pattern. And you just have to glue it together. To get the full size thing. And the neat thing about this is you cut it out on these lines, and that line becomes the line that we will sew on, or the finished edge of the garment, so that you cut it out with a little extra seam allowance. I'll show you along the way. On this whole project, the outside edges run wild, so don't ever worry about them. Just cut it out along the curves, and you will end up with all your pattern pieces. There's 12 of them. They are numbered 1 through 12, so you don't get confused. And I found it very important to keep things in the numbered order, and even to write the number on the fabric as I was marking it, because that kept me straight about not only where it went, but what side was up. Some fabrics, you can't tell the right side from the wrong side. You don't have to be too fussy about these curves, because it's all irregular, and big versus small makes it look interesting, so you don't have to obsess over it. Just be swoopy and curvy, and just make them pretty curves. I'll show you with a piece of silk here. A lot of fabrics you can just mark with a pencil. And once again, I was saying, you don't have to be too carefully fussy about it. Oops, yeah, when it does that, see how I've got the pencil down low? That kind of helps the snag issue. I always write the number somewhere in the seam allowance. So the right side is down on this, and when you put it on the product, it'll be this way. But if you do always do that, if you make a mirror image of this, you know, the upside down version, it will not work. So the one thing you do have to keep track of on this is what's the right side and what's the wrong side. And the trick for marking on dark fabrics, a very old-fashioned method of marking on dark fabrics. Where's my piece of chalk? So it's a little sliver of soap when you're almost going to throw it out. And it's nice and sharp because of just the way it is from being a bar of soap. You can also use tailor's chalk. There's some tailor's chalk that's wax, and when you iron it, it disappears. So that's because there is a lot of ironing involved with this. That's probably not the best idea because all your lines will disappear. Look how beautifully a piece of chalk marks on dark fabric. And this is the wax tailor's chalk. This will disappear when you iron it. So. And you can't even write numbers with the chalk if you're clever. So sometimes I have included fancy fabrics in the kit, which add richness and wonderfulness, except it's very hard to see the lines on them. I've actually drawn really hard with a pen the line on this, and you can still barely see it. And so what I do with those then is sew around this line with the machine, because that transfers this line to the front where I need to see it. Some fabrics that are particularly sheer, like the silks, it's going to be double at the edge where it's folded under, and see here how the black shows through, and that's odd looking. So that's why I line them sometimes. And the lining can be any old fabric as long as it's as big as the sample piece, so that, let me show you this as if it was lined, and when it's folded under. See, now the orange looks completely orange without seeing that shadow. You don't always have to do this, and if I'm giving you sheer fabrics in your kit that need the lining, I'll also give you a piece of lining, but I think there's these very pale colors are probably the only ones that are like that. So on the lightweight fabrics, I lined them, and the lining is something that will never show. It's just to give the fabric a little more opacity. So you can use any piece of junk, not pretty, because it's not going to show. So I drew the lines on and then stitched around the edges, and then can you get me a scissors, please, Leah? Oh, here, I've got a scissors. And this is like, I like to do the sewing first and the cutting out afterwards, so that you're not trying to sew close to an edge, it just isn't necessary. And I cut it out with about a half an inch seam allowance. Once again, just let the straight edges run wild. I got a little short here, but we'll cope with that. Oops, you do have to cut through both layers. And then you clip the curves. You want to be about an eighth of an inch away from the thread line. And the tighter the curve is, the closer your clips should be. And you flip it over and iron the edges under. And you make sure, if you can get real close and see, make sure that the line is on this side of the fold. If you fold it right just to where the clips are, you'll sort of get little square points. It won't be as beautiful a curve. And the whole point of this is to just make a beautiful curve. So I can take you over to the ironing board later and show you how to do this ironing. But when you're done, you end up with a piece, and you can prep all 12 of them and then do the fun part of sticking them on the background. So these are both right side up now. I'll show you the one that's lined. You can do this just with the pencil mark, but to me it's easier to see the stitching line. And I don't know how close you can get to see that. See where I'm folding it here? The clip does not go where the fold is. The fold is beyond the clip a little bit, and that sort of helps it stay. Be helpful if I turn the iron on. That helps it stay in a nice, gentle curve. And I'm always getting it to the point where I can see the thread line. And of course, it's all just iron, so if you don't like it, you can flatten it out and start over and try again a different way. So here's one side all ironed, and I find it easiest to so that you don't booger up this side you've already ironed. It's very skinny down here, so I'm going to trim a little of this out of the way. And if some of this thread shows on the right side, it's just thread. You can always rip it out later if it shows on your finished product. That's why you basted it. Where are you going, curve? Down, down. And you know the difference between pressing and ironing? Pressing is just straight down, so now the one that's a little bit stuck up, straight down. Straight down, we'll keep it well behaved. That looks pretty good. And some of these, I can always rip those out if I don't like them later. This is the fancy fabric that's hard to see the lines on, and you can kind of see them here. So this one, I should have used bright red thread or something, but we will do the same thing. I think I do this step because I like the look of this slight rolled edge that the fold gives you. It's just part of the richness of the design to me. And keeping it just on the edge of the iron, you know, I'm keeping the iron away from the part I did already. And you see, this fabric does not take the ironing as nicely as the silk does. And so what I've actually done on some fabrics like this that are very difficult is by hand run a basting stitch here that folds all those down to keep it organized. Or this would also be a good one maybe to do with fusible instead of with sewing, but I'm biased towards the sewing part. Or at least this one when you pin it, you know, so you can get it to behave when you're pinning it down, so you could just get all these little edges tucked in when you're pinning them. Or conversely, if you're gonna step away from this project for a day and come back to it, you could always put a weight on it, you know, a heavy weight or a book, and ignore it over the weekend while you do something else and then come back to it. It might be better behaved at that point. So.